Okay, so welcome everybody to this journal club and review talk. As you, most of you might have heard, a few days back there was a report of getting superconductivity at room temperatures, in the sense about 15 degrees centigrade, but of course at a very, very high pressures in a compound which is described as carbonaceous sulfur hydride. So we asked Professor Pratap Rai Choudhury, who is an expert on superconductivity in TIFR, to give a review talk. This, of course, goes back to an old idea of Neil Ashcroft's, and there has been an overall, both theoretical and experimental developments towards using what is known as metallic hydrogen as a superconductor. And Pratap has very kindly agreed to give us a review of this, both from the theory and the experiment perspectives. So over to you, Pratap.
Okay, thank you, Rasdeep.
Just one thing, our viewers on YouTube Live, if you have questions, please type in the chat and we will try to take it up at the end of the talk. For people who are joining us in Zoom, also either raise your hand or more preferably type in the chat and we will try to take up the questions with Pratap in between. Okay. Oh, okay. Sorry. Over to Pratap. Go ahead. No.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So what I will be reviewing today is this paper, which was published in the middle of October this year. It's a very recent paper. And this is the first report where a superconducting transition is observed at a temperature higher than 273 Kelvin. So it's about 15 degrees higher than that. So that's about the temperature of a well-air-conditioned room. So this is, of course, from the discovery of superconductivity, this has been a long wait and it has been a holy grail. So room temperature superconductivity, we had to wait roughly for 110 years. And therefore, this is quite a remarkable discovery, even though it has some limitations that will become apparent as I get along. So when preparing this review, I discussed with several people, and in particular, I'd like to acknowledge Gautam Dutt Mukherjee, from whom I understood, who explained to me actually in great detail this technique of generating very high pressure and doing measurements on materials. Sushant Konar in NCRA, whom I have never met, but I keep meeting on Facebook. And Professor R. Nagarajan, our old colleague, who is now in CBS in Kalina campus. And we also had very interesting discussions when I was preparing this review talk. Okay, so let's start from the genesis of the problem. So the genesis of this problem, which led to eventually this discovery of room temperature superconductivity, it dates back to 1935 in this theoretical paper of Wigner and Huntington, where they predicted that you could have a metallic phase of hydrogen. So what is metallic hydrogen? To understand that, let's start with the basic property of hydrogen. We know that hydrogen is a gas, and at one atmospheric pressure, if you liquefy it, then at 20 Kelvin, it's a liquid. And then if you cool it further, then at 14 Kelvin, it becomes a solid. Now, hydrogen as a solid is an insulator. And this has baffled people for many years, and it's possibly still baffling people, researchers to some extent. And the reason is the following. Look at this periodic table of elements. Hydrogen is here, and then all this column here, the rest of the elements is what we know as alkali metal. Now, alkali metals, they have one electron outside a filled inert gas shell. For example, if you see lithium, it has helium inert gas shell plus one electron in the next s orbital. And as a result, that these are very good metals. In fact, they are nearly free electron metals. They are almost textbook free electron metals, and they are metals both in solid and liquid state. Now, the reason why hydrogen is baffling is that solid hydrogen is not a metal. Solid hydrogen is an insulator, even though hydrogen also has just one electron in the 1s orbital. Of course, there is nothing below because it has just 1s electron. And why is hydrogen an insulator? The reason is that when hydrogen solidifies, it forms a Bravais lattice like this, but it's not a Bravais lattice of hydrogen atoms. It's a Bravais lattice of hydrogen molecules. So at every point of the lattice, you have actually a hydrogen molecule. If you apply pressure on this solid, then it undergoes several transformations. But no matter what the structure is, at the lattice points of the structure, you have a molecule of H2 instead of the atom H. Now, what was realized quite early on is that instead of this molecule, if you could form a Bravais lattice of atomic hydrogen, doesn't matter what the Bravais lattice is, it would be a metal. So, Wigner and Huntington, what they did is they started taking hypothetical Bravais lattices of atomic hydrogen, and then they calculated the free energy to see if any of these lattices could be stable. And what they realized that yes, it would have a point of stability, and at that point of stability, the lattice constant would be roughly one and a half times. It will be possible three times the Bohr radius. So that means about 1.5 angstrom. Now this is a very small lattice constant for a solid. If you take metallic hydrogen, on the other hand, that we know exists at low temperature and people have studied in great detail, there the lattice constant is more like 3 to 4 angstrom. So therefore, if you calculate the density of this hypothetical atomic hydrogen would be about 10 times that of molecular hydrogen. So it's a much more dense system. And what Wigner and Huntington predicted is that metallic hydrogen could exist at very high pressure. They put also a number to this pressure and they said above 25 gigapascal, probably hydrogen would become a metal. Now, before we proceed, let us first clarify the units of pressure, because it's a real jungle out there. You have Pascal, you have bar, you have torr, you have atmosphere, you have millimeter of mercury. So you have hundreds of units of pressure, and different communities use different units. And even for someone like me who is always dealing with pressure and vacuum and so on, it is very difficult to remember the conversion of one unit to the other. So in this talk, everything that I will talk about, I will mention the pressure in gigapascal. So what is gigapascal? First, let's start with 1 bar. 1 bar is actually 1 atmospheric pressure. The pressure, the atmospheric pressure that you have at the sea level, roughly let's say the atmospheric pressure in Bombay, P1. And then 1 gigapascal is 10 to the power 9 pascal, that is 10,000 atmospheric pressure. So 10,000 bar, which is 10 kilobar. Now you know that at the sea level, you have your pressure is about 1 bar. To get a scale of things, the pressure in the core of the earth, that is about 360 gigapascal. And what the kind of pressures that I will be concerned about today is in tens and hundreds of gigapascal. So it is actually pressures that are comparable to this. All right. So after this Wigner and Huntington's prediction, people started applying pressure on hydrogen and they started looking for metallic hydrogen with whatever technology was available at that time in 1935 onward, and no one found any metallic hydrogen. Of course, not finding metallic hydrogen has never deterred. So not finding something experimentally has never deterred a true-blooded theorist from making theoretical prediction. And therefore, even though no one had ever seen metallic hydrogen, Neil Ashcroft made a very interesting prediction. So Neil Ashcroft is more known possibly among any condensed matter physicist for his book, this Ashcroft and Marmion's textbook on solid state physics is from where generations of students learn their solid state, particularly on the electronic properties of solids. It's one of the most popular and authoritative textbooks. So Neil Ashcroft predicted the following. He said, okay, metallic hydrogen, if it existed, then it would be a high temperature superconductor. Doesn't matter that metallic hydrogen doesn't exist. But if it exists, it would be a high temperature superconductor. And what went in this prediction is actually remarkably simple. So in this prediction, he just used a slight modified form of the BCS theory, of the BCS equation for the superconducting transition temperature. So this equation is essentially this is a celebrated equation. What BCS theory tells us is that the superconducting transition temperature is proportional to theta D. Theta D is actually D, the Debye temperature of the solid. And then it is exponentially damped by this factor e to the power minus 1 by this 1 by some quantity here, and this quantity together, it is the attractive interaction between the electrons that form the Cooper pair. Now, I have written this thing in a slightly oversimplified form, but nevertheless, this will capture the physics. This denominator has two terms. One of the terms is this attractive electron-phonon interaction that comes from BCS theory directly. But then you also have another blue quantity here, mu. And this is because you know that electrons have a negative charge. So therefore, the electrons will also have a repulsive interaction among each other. So superconductivity requires this quantity, N0 V phonon, which is the attractive interaction, to be larger than this repulsive interaction. Now, this repulsive interaction, if you have a metal where the screening is very good, the repulsive interaction is small. Nevertheless, in principle, you will always have it. Now, alkali metals, even though they are all very good metals, they are nearly free electron metals, they are not superconductors. And why are they not superconductors? The answer to some extent lies in the fact that they are very good metals. Because they are very good metals, they have a large bandwidth. And since they have a large bandwidth, they have a small density of states at Fermi level. So N0 is very small. And therefore, this attractive interaction on the whole is small. And it is nearly compensated by this mu star. Sometimes it can also be overcompensated by the mu star, in which case this factor, it just becomes zero because it is e to the power minus infinity. And it also has a moderate Debye temperature. So even if it is not compensated, it is nearly compensated, so it's very small And then you have a reasonably low Debye temperature. So therefore, the TC becomes extremely small, smaller than any measurement temperature that we have achieved so far, or it becomes just zero if it is overcompensated. Okay, now what is special about metallic hydrogen? So you know that if you consider a solid as a collection, as a mass spring system, the atoms are masses connected by the bonds, which you can consider as elastic. They can be, you can consider them as springs. Then the spring elastic constant, if it is K and the atomic mass is M, then this Debye temperature is proportional to root over K by M. Now in metallic hydrogen, this M is very small because hydrogen is a very light atom. And since this metallic hydrogen, the hypothetical idealized metallic hydrogen has a very large density, the atoms are very close to each other, and therefore the K is considerably large. And because of that, the metallic hydrogen has a large Debye temperature. So these are all calculated quantities. No one has seen any metallic hydrogen. So this is for the idealized metallic hydrogen. So you have theta D, which is 3500 Kelvin, is enormously large. And N0VF minus mu star, if you calculate this again for that particular structure, you will get a reasonably large quantity, so which is about 0.25. You put this back in this expression and calculate, you will get a TC which is between 50 to 60 Kelvin. In today's world, 50 to 60 Kelvin doesn't sound as very high. But when, remember, this paper was being written in 1968, and at that time, the highest TC by that time was something like 20 Kelvin or 22 Kelvin, and 50 to 60 Kelvin was very high compared to that. Okay, good. It was a nice theoretical prediction, but of course, you don't have any metallic hydrogen. So, Ashcroft started looking for situations where you could have metallic hydrogen, if not on Earth, elsewhere in the universe, and where this prediction could have some impact. And one of such places happens to be the core of Jupiter. So here in Jupiter, if you see this, it has a rock and ice core at the center, but outside that, it has hydrogen, which under gravity is at very high pressure. So, and it's also at moderately low temperature. So, in fact, Ashcroft really became enamored with this idea of superconductivity in hydrogen. But since solid hydrogen is not inside, and the prediction was that in Jupiter, this metallic hydrogen is actually a liquid. Ashcroft started working out with his students and collaborators on whether superconductivity can be seen in metallic hydrogen. Now, remember, there is no liquid that is a superconductor. For example, mercury is a liquid at room temperature, and when you cool it, it becomes superconducting at 4.2 Kelvin. But by the time it is superconducting, it has become a solid. So you have no liquid metal that also becomes a superconductor when it is in the liquid form. But in this series of papers, one in 81 and one in 83, Ashcroft predicted that liquid metallic hydrogen could be a new kind of superconductors, which is superconductor while it is in the liquid state. And he went even one step ahead and started calculating the critical fields of this hypothetical liquid metallic hydrogen superconductor. All right, and I think in those around that time, for example, this is something that I found in 1969, where someone had explored the possibility that the supercurrents in this superconducting hydrogen, liquid hydrogen, whether it could be responsible for the magnetic field, for the large magnetic field around Jupiter. Now, from what I understand by talking to Sushan Konar and some other people, that this narrative now is no longer part of the mainstream narrative in astronomy. But nevertheless, it was explored for a while. Now, then Ashcroft, of course, solid metallic hydrogen was not there, liquid metallic hydrogen was also not there. So at least for any laboratory scale experiment, these predictions were not very useful. But Ashcroft loved this idea, what I understand. So I do not know Ashcroft personally. He has spent a long career in Cornell, and those who are from Cornell in this audience would possibly know Ashcroft better. But from what I see from these papers, he was really, really enamored by this idea of metallic hydrogen and then superconductivity in metallic hydrogen. He really wanted almost this hydrogen to become a metal and to become a superconductor. So, okay, when atomic hydrogen was sort of not really synthesized, or no one could get atomic hydrogen, and of course metallic hydrogen, then Ashcroft and Richardson, they started doing more calculation, and they started exploring that maybe even if hydrogen remains a molecular solid, could high enough pressure drive it into a metal and into a superconductor? So he wrote several papers. I am just showing one here. And all these papers, remember, it is essentially BCS theory and a little bit beyond BCS theory. So for those who are familiar in this audience with a little bit of superconductivity, the basics of superconductivity theory, BCS theory has two parts. So Bardeen-Cooper-Schrieffer theory, which is almost the only authoritative theory of superconductivity, which explains almost all the conventional superconductors. Now it has two parts. One part of it is BCS theory itself. And then the second part is BCS approximation. So BCS have to do certain approximation to get nice looking formula of the kind that I have shown you before. Now, what is done in all these papers of Neil Ashcroft is that it takes BCS theory, but then tries to go beyond BCS approximation. So you don't consider the electron-photon attractive interaction to be completely K-independent and a constant up to some energy, which is the Debye energy. So you put in realistic structure of phonon density of states and so on. But in essence, it is still BCS theory. It has a name, it's called Elias-Bark theory. Often when you go beyond the BCS approximation, you can no longer forget nice analytical solution, and you have to do it computationally. Okay, so while all these predictions were going on, experimentalists were of course not sitting idle. There was continuous quest to find metallic hydrogen, and in fact the first one that sort of found liquid hydrogen was metallic hydrogen in the liquid state. So here in this experiment, what was done is the following. Hydrogen was taken in a small container And then it was subjected to an enormous shockwave to create pressure which is of the order of 180 gigapascal. However, this, since we are using a shockwave, this is pressure is created for a very short time. So it's about tens of microsecond. And what was observed is this, that if you do a very precise measurement of resistivity, then you see that the resistivity decreases with pressure and becomes actually very small. So here the resistivity is 0001 ohm centimeter, and this goes towards the resolution limit of the experiment. So this is not really a proof of metallicity, because the temperature is uncontrolled. When you apply this huge shockwave, you have the sample temperature heats up to about 2000 to 4000 Kelvin. Nevertheless, this large decrease in the resistance, it's a signature, it's sort of a preliminary signature that you could have a metallic hydrogen state. However, this is a liquid metallic hydrogen, so this is not the solid form. So this would be the liquid metallic hydrogen, for example, that you have in the core of Jupiter. At the same time, now this experiment is more or less accepted and later on has also been repeated, I think, by one group. So it is now more or less something that has stood the test of time. However, for solid metallic hydrogen, people are not so lucky. There was this paper by Rangadas and Isaac Silvera. So by the way, Rangadas is the same person whose discovery of room temperature superconductivity provoked today's review talk. But at that time, I think he was either a student or he was a postdoc working with Silvera, who was a senior author. And they claim to have found metallic hydrogen. In fact, the article name is very categorical: observation of the Wigner-Huntington transition to metallic hydrogen. So they claim that the solid hydrogen goes through various phases. Then you have here metallic liquid hydrogen. Then at pressures which are about, I think, 460 gigapascal, you get here solid metallic hydrogen. Now this was done not by measuring electrical resistance directly. Let's say the way you take a multimeter and measure the resistance of a sample, but this was done optically by looking at the optical reflectivity. So this result, when it was published, it was received with a large degree of skepticism. There was a lot of criticism from other groups that it might not be correct. And these people did not also repeat the measure. Sorry, they couldn't reproduce the measurement. And later they also published an erratum, which was not essentially retracting the claim, but effectively which nullified the claim. So this work essentially is no longer believed to be a proof of metallic hydrogen. In 2019, just last year, there was this observation again of metallic hydrogen at 425 gigapascal, and this was now by a group in France. So what they observed is, again, they measured reflectivity. So actually, no. Here, what they were measuring is the transmission of an infrared light through the hydrogen solid. And what they saw is that initially the hydrogen is an insulator, it's a large band gap insulator. So the light is just transmitted, and then suddenly you see that the light does not transmit anymore. And this is where they said that the insulating gap has crashed to zero, so you have gotten a metal. Now, this paper has been on archive since last year. I couldn't find it published anywhere. It's possibly not yet published. Why? I really don't know. But the upshot of all this is that solid metallic hydrogen is still not something that we have conclusively in a laboratory. Now, you can see that all these experiments, they entail very high pressure, pressures which are exceeding the core of Earth, for example, 425 gigapascal. So first, let me show you the tool of how to achieve such high pressure. So the central tool that's sort of the heart at all these experiments is what is called a diamond anvil cell. So you take two pieces of diamond and you cut them in a way so that you have this large face here, and here you make a small face. So now what you do is that you put your sample in between the small face, the smaller face of the two diamond. So here I have a sample, and then you have this is sort of on the side, it is sealed with a gasket. So you have a metallic gasket that prevents, let's say, anything to go out from in between this gap. And you put normally a pressure transmitting medium. That pressure transmitting medium can be a fine powder of, let's say, it could be something like talcum powder, it could be sodium chloride powder. If you are doing at room temperature, you could use liquid, or sometimes you can even use things like gas. And that is what will be done here, because people will be studying largely gaseous systems that solidify at low temperature. And you also normally put another ruby crystal here. And this ruby crystal is actually what you use. It's your sensor to measure the pressure inside this diamond anvil cell. So typically this spacing between these two faces will be 10 micron, between 10 and 100 micron. And this diameter of this space, it depends on how much pressure you want to go. So what you do is that you press these two diamonds against each other. You apply the force here on the large face, but since here you have a very small face, this force, the pressure that you get here is enormous. So this face diameter is something that can be from, let's say, 100 micron down to 10 micron or so. You diamond is transparent, and therefore it is reasonably comfortable to do optical measurements here. You shine light from the top and you can collect it from the bottom. One of the measurements that most groups working on high pressure do is Raman measurement. They look at the Raman vibrational modes. And actually, the Raman modes of ruby, it shifts its pressure, and that is what you use as your pressure calibration. So that is what you use to know at what pressure you are. And this is your experimental sample. So there are plenty of labs, like, for example, in BRC, in ICER Kolkata, which can achieve regularly pressures of 10 to 15 gigapascal, some of them a factor of 2 more than that, going up to, let's say, 50 gigapascal. And many labs do optical measurement, because optical measurements are the most convenient one to do in this kind of a setup. There are only few labs in the world 3 to 4 labs who can, it's more than that possibly, but there are few, much smaller number of labs which can go to larger pressures, let's say up to 500 gigapascal. And then there are really, really few labs, 3 to 4 labs, who can actually do this also at low temperature. And then the number of labs who can do, in addition to that, electrical and magnetic measurements at this tremendously high pressure, that you can count on your on the fingers on one hand. So these are, yes.
What is the typical size of the sample that one puts in these diamond anvil cells?
You'll be seeing that, but the typical size of samples could be 10. So for regular diamond anvils, these kind ones, which are the ones that you have everywhere, the kind of sample size could be 100 micron, 150 micron. But the ones that I will be showing today, these will be much smaller. These will be tens of microns.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. All right. Tens of microns, just because of the fact that if you have to increase the pressure, this has to be smaller. The diamond anvil end has to be more pointed.
Right. No, understood. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So keep this in mind. If anyone has any confusion, here is the time to ask, because after this I'll be showing you data, and once we get a slight hang of the data, I'll be giving you a step-by-step account of how the experiment is performed. So, but here you have the basic principle of the diamond anvil cell with which you apply the pressure.
So if you have questions, you can raise your hand and we'll go one by one if you have questions at this point.
Yes, feel free to interrupt and ask questions if you have any. All right.
A question. Yeah.
So there was no direct evidence of metallic hydrogen, but there were other progresses that happened. And that brought back this the work of Ashcroft into focus again. One of the major discovery was superconductivity at 39 Kelvin in MgB2, magnesium diboride. So magnesium diboride has a structure which has this, it's a hexagonal structure. You have this magnesium layer and this boron layer. And magnesium diboride, the important thing is that it has relatively light elements. So you had magnesium, which is not very heavy as a metal, and it has boron, which is very light. And then it was found out that it has a superconducting transition temperature at 39 Kelvin. You don't have to apply any pressure. And more importantly, in the 80s, when HITC was discovered, HITC had many complications, and therefore people thought that if you have to get high superconducting transition temperature, you cannot do it BCS theory. You need to have something more exotic, maybe resonance valence bond, maybe something else, but good old BCS theory will not work. Here it happened that other than the fact that magnesium diboride has two bands, which makes it very interesting, it's a conventional BCS superconductor. So there is no exoticity that has both been a theorist boon and an experimentalist nightmare in HITC qubits. Okay, but something else also happened. This was a really dirty set of experimental data that came out in 2002 and 2003. But nevertheless, these data, what they showed was that you did not have superconductivity in hydrogen yet, But sorry, I'm sorry. You did not have superconductivity in hydrogen, but people found superconductivity under pressure in lithium. Now remember, lithium in the periodic table is just below hydrogen. So lithium, when you apply pressure, when you apply pressure of about tens of gigapascal, here this is a 34 gigapascal, then it was observed that it has this resistance drop. Now, you can ask me here that whether such a resistance drop implies superconductivity. Well, I don't think it does. It is not going anywhere towards to zero resistance. It's just a superconducting drop. Of course, if you apply magnetic field, the drop shifts to lower temperature. This was again reproduced by another group here who also found similar things. And then there was a third group who found that this, instead of doing this resistance measurement, they measured the AC susceptibility and they also could observe signature of diamagnetism. None of these are clean data. Nevertheless, remember, there are people like Ashcroft who have been wanting to see superconductivity in light elements, mainly hydrogen, but lithium is the next best that you have, for decades, for maybe five decades. And for them, this small indication that there could be a superconductivity in lithium, which is the element just below hydrogen, was interesting enough. And these papers got published in reasonable places. Possibly they wouldn't have gotten published if they were from smaller places or countries like ours, but definitely from these groups, which are much bigger groups, they got published in reasonably good places. Well, it also happens that in 1985, there were these two gentlemen, they had also observed very similar feature. In fact, you can see that they here, for example, you see this small drop in the resistance. They also had observed this small drop in the resistance. But I think in 1985, people were more conservative and did not claim victory by just looking at very weak signatures. And they did not go ahead to claim this as superconductivity. They just said resistance anomaly, and maybe it could be superconductivity. Maybe if they were bold enough to say that this is superconductivity, they should have published in Nature. All right.
So Pratap, one question from Shauman is, what is being plotted in the middle plots for lithium? I guess the second reference that you were giving. Yeah.
This one. Okay. Yeah. What is being plotted here is, this is the resistance. So you are passing a current and you are measuring the voltage. So what they are plotting is just the voltage and not divided by the current. I don't know why they plot it like this. And on the other side, what is plotted is the AC susceptibility. AC susceptibility is dmdh in the limit of very small magnetic field. Again, when you measure AC susceptibility, you pass a AC current in a coil, so you produce the AC magnetic field, and then you place your sample inside another coil, and you look at the induced voltage in that second coil. So this is that induced voltage. And this induced voltage gives you, so normally AC susceptibility has the real and imaginary component, which corresponds to the inductive and the dissipative part. Here in this measurement, they did not separate the two. They just measured the total amplitude, which is the real square plus imaginary square root over, and this is what you are seeing here. So all of these show some anomaly at some temperature. All right. However, this NGV2 plus lithium together was enough for Ashcroft to again get very excited, and he revisited now the problem, but this time he explored hydrogen dominant metallic alloys. So he said, okay, you cannot get hydrogen as a metal, but there are many alloys of hydrogen. So if you take some of these hydrides, these covalent hydrides, they could have hydrogen density, which are already very high. So therefore, they could be under, means you could have the pressure, which is already high because of the bonding with the host. So this is what is called chemical pressure or pre-pressurizing by the chemical host.
Can I ask a question here?
Yeah.
Yeah, Pratap, so this is essentially what you're saying is a molecular, now you're showing methane in this case.
Yeah.
But it's an example, you're saying it as a hydride, but typically, chemically, hydrides are ones that are full of electrons. And in a methane, the normal understanding of electronic structure for methane includes that the hydrogen is actually electron deficient. The carbon is the electron sink. So how does one think about comparing the two? Because in dihydrogen or the molecular solid of dihydrogen, it's slightly different electronic structure in the way the electrons are distributed amongst the hydrogen.
Okay, the honest answer is that I don't know. Because what I read from this paper, the idea is that, okay, methane was something that was just taken to do a model calculation in this paper. But what was used later on was not methane, but was other things, hydrogen, rare earth hydrides, for example, and things like that. Now, what you are saying is also the case at atmospheric ambient pressure. But here, when you apply this humongous pressure, then the structure changes very significantly. And the hydrogens come much closer to each other. So the hydrogen density becomes much higher, where the claim is that you can have metallization.
Okay, fine, thanks.
All right. So about the details of the calculation of metallization, this is well beyond my purview. These are essentially DFT kind of calculations, and possibly people like Ravi would know much better. Okay. So here the idea was that if you take this kind of, if you take alloys of hydrogen, then you will already have pre-pressurization. And you can achieve the density of hydrogen similar to metallic hydrogen, but at a much lower pressure. So a model calculation was done with methane. And here the what was predicted is that the density of methane at 38 gigapascal is the same. The H density of methane at 38 gigapascal is the same as H2 when compressed to 150 gigapascal. However, now this was calculated and later on found out to be reasonably correct. However, methane, when people pressurize, it never metallized. So what Jyotishman was saying may be right. I don't know if that is the reason. I have not read it in these papers, but even when the density or hydrogen density in methane was equivalent to the density in hydrogen gas compressed to 150 gigapascal or much more, no metallization was observed. And as I said before, all these calculations, the heart of the superconducting calculations was BCS-Eliasberg theory. There was nothing beyond that. So it was calculating, let's say, the Debye energy, calculating the attractive electron-phonon interaction from the density of states of phonons and the electron-phonon interaction constant alpha, and calculating the Coulomb pseudo potential. That's all that went into the theory. Okay, now, as I told you, methane people pressurized and it did not metallize. Around this time, Ashok published another paper where he said, okay, since methane so far has not been metallized up to pressure of 301 GPa, why don't we try with silane, which is silicon hydrogen 4? And then he said that it offers an attractive possibility for hydrogen-rich high-TC superconductor at accessible pressure. They went on doing this calculation to find all possible structures of Si4 that you could get at high pressure. So though superconductivity is mentioned in the paper, here the emphasis was more on metallizing the silicon hydride, possibly after this failure of being able to metallize methane. But with silicon hydride, the success was much more. So in Emirates, 2 years later, Emirates is a group in Max Planck Institute in Germany. So they took silicon hydride, and then when they applied a pressure of 192 gigapascal, they saw that there is a resistance drop, and in fact, a resistance drop that goes to zero. So in fact, there was superconductivity in silane. Here you can see the sample. Now, unfortunately, there is a lot of complicacy in silane. So as you have seen before, silane can have many, many different structures under pressure. And it happens that some of these structures coexist. So for example, you can see here, this is an optical image, and you can see color contrast. Some of the regions appeared as transparent and some of the region as darker, opaque. So it's a mixture of two structures of silane, one of which is metallic and the other one which is insulating. And the metallic one also shows superconductivity at low temperature. But this is why your superconducting transitions are not very sharp and they show this kind of darky features here. Nevertheless, if you measure the TC, you could see that the TC is up to, let's say, 17 Kelvin or so, which is not necessarily high TC, but nevertheless, means you at least have superconductivity in silane. In methane, you have neither metallicity nor superconductivity. Here you have a hydrogen compound which is showing you superconductivity at pressures which are close to 100 gigapascal. What they mention in this paper is that their way of loading the sample was very difficult because silane is poisonous. So you have to load the sample inside a globe box and then create the pressure. Then you have to completely evacuate the glove box and take the pressure cell out. And because of that, this pressure range, which probably was interesting and maybe you would have silane with higher TC, they couldn't prepare any sample in the intermediate temperature range. In the intermediate pressure range. But what they studied also in great detail was the crystal structure. So one of the things that you can measure, as I told you, optical measurements are reasonably straightforward to do in a pressure cell. And optical measurements include X-ray diffraction measurements. So you can do X-ray diffraction with your sample inside the pressure cell. And this X-ray diffraction measurement, what they showed was this: at low pressure, you have insulating silane. This is what they are plotting here, is the unit cell volume. And then you suddenly have a first order transition, and then these points are the metallic silane. At this point, it is not necessarily SiH4. It becomes SiHn, and the N is difficult to determine. So it's a compound with silicon and hydrogen, but not necessarily with the stoichiometry of silane. And then in this range here, so you have metallic silane, and in this range, you have actually two kinds of structure. One which is metallic and reflecting, the other which is transparent and insulating. That is what I showed you even visually in the optical image before. Now, what they also found, and this is interesting, the HH distance. So look at this metallic silane. The HH distance in plane is 1.54 angstrom. Out of plane, it is smaller. It is 1.15 angstrom. And both of these are much smaller than the silicon hydrogen distance. So you are forming effectively a three-dimensional network of hydrogen. If you want, this is in a, some sort of realization of that hypothetical metallic hydrogen, which has been elusive so far. Okay. More importantly, from this you can calculate the density, and at 60 gigapascal here, there are four hydrogen atoms in a volume of 4.5 angstrom cube, which is equivalent to 500 gigapascal for hydrogen gas. So this basic premise of Ashcroft is completely supported, that you take this compound and you can get hydrogen densities which are much, much larger at relatively smaller pressure compared to hydrogen gas. Okay, so then with silane, one could get superconductivity, but not necessarily at very high temperature. So the next thing that to try was hydrogen sulfide. Now, by this time, there was this group of Yangmin Ma. This is a Chinese group. These are people who do density functional theory calculations. And they started looking at various possibilities of hydrogen-rich compounds and looking at their possible structures under pressure and whether there is any possibility of first metallization and second superconductivity. So the superconducting transition, the temperature estimate, predicting it is extremely difficult from such calculation. But nevertheless, they predicted that for dense hydrogen sulfide, you will get a transition temperature of 80 Kelvin at 160 GPa. So this was enough for people to try it out. And when they tried, the surprise was that instead of 80 Kelvin, they got 203 Kelvin. So you got three times higher than what this Chinese group had dared to predict. Okay, now, Rajdeep, am I exceeding my time?
Oh, no, you can go on. We are usually flexible about this. But I had one question for you.
Yeah.
All along, what you have showed us is resistivity data dropping, and from various reasons, including, you know, when we got some data from ISU before, there was a focus on getting the, you know, diamagnetic susceptibility to confirm that it is a superconductor.
Yeah, I will show you that.
So in, I'm just saying, in these measurements, they had actually done and shown that.
Yeah, so just hold on, you'll see.
Okay.
You'll see that. Okay, now this, so far I have not told you really how step by step the measurement is done. Remember, you are putting a sample normally when you do a resistance measurement, you have this sample, you connect 4 wires here, you pass current through 2 wires, you measure the voltage through the 2 other wires, and that is how you do a resistance measurement. When you are applying these humongous pressures, how are you having contacts, and then how are the wires coming out? So it almost seems impossible. So now, at this stage, having given you a feel of the data, let me show you step by step how the experiment is done. So this is your diamond anvil that I have shown you before. The first step is you take a stainless steel plate. This is a stainless steel plate. And you put that stainless steel plate in the diamond anvil. Initially, this hole in the stainless steel plate is not there. It's just a continuous plate. And you apply a pressure of 17 to 20 gigapascal. So that creates an indent on this stainless steel plate. Okay? You get this indent like this. And then you drill a hole at the center, which is about 200 micrometer. So this is the hole that you have created in this stainless steel plate. Okay, now stainless steel is a metal. If your sample is touching stainless steel, then it will get short circuited and there is no way you will be able to measure resistivity. So you have to somehow insulate your sample from the stainless steel. What you do in the step two is that you release this pressure and then you feel here an insulating powder. That insulating powder can be many things. It can be Teflon, it can be sodium chloride, it can be calcium sulfur oxide. So this is the one that they have used. And CaSO4 is used because it is transparent to the radiations that they were using, to the light wavelengths that was of their interest. You fill that with this powder and then you press again. And then when you press again, this powder becomes a solid and this gives you this yellow thing, which is an insulating spacer. You press it with just the correct amount of pressure so that the thickness of this spacer is about 3 to 5 micron. How do you know? You have these two anvils here and you can pass light. So you do interference experiment and adjust it. All right, then you drill a hole in this yellow insulating spacer, which is much smaller. And this hole that you drill here is about 10 to 30 micrometer. This is this small hole here. Now you take out the top diamond and you deposit 4 titanium pads. These 4 titanium pads are the on this, so they are deposited on the diamond. That is how it will look like. And these are the ones that will operate as your current and voltage lead for electrical measurement when it makes a contact with whatever you put in this tiny hole. So your sample will be only in this tiny red region here, which has a width of 3 to 5 micron, a thickness of 3 to 5 micron, and a width of 10 to 30 micron. Okay, so if you want a cartoon, it will be like this. You will have this tiny region here where you have this sample which is pressurized, and you have these 4 contacts which are actually evaporated on this diamond here, and this evaporated pads are making contact with the sample. You pass a current and measure the voltage. Good. How do you load the sample? Most of the measurement that I am showing you, you are loading a gas. So the way you load it is the following. Your gas or a liquid. So something that's a gas at room temperature, but by this temperature, it becomes a liquid. So in the hydrogen sulfide experiment, hydrogen sulfide at 1 atmosphere, it has a liquefaction temperature of 187 Kelvin. So you have here your diamond anvil cell. it is surrounded by this mechanical structure. This is what you press mechanically with a force, and that is what gives you the pressure here, because it gets amplified by this factor, which is proportional to this area at the top of this region here and the area for diamond anvil. So that's a multiplicative factor that determines your pressure. Okay, you have this capillary here through which you flood hydrogen sulfide, keeping your cell at a temperature which is lower than the liquefaction temperature. So liquefaction at 1 atmosphere is 187 Kelvin, but here you can keep anywhere between 191 to 213 Kelvin. And the reason for that is that you are loading hydrogen sulfide from a pressurized cylinder, and a cylinder is already at 20-30 atmosphere. So already your liquefaction temperature is higher. So you flood this entire region with liquid, and you keep a separation between the two diamonds, which is about 50 micron, so that your liquid can enter here and then fill this space here. Then you look from the top with a microscope, with an optical microscope, and you can see the moment the liquid is filled here, you will see a sudden change of contrast. So you look from the top with a microscope and you are looking at a 30 micron area. But the moment you see this contrast change, you know that it has filled with liquid hydrogen sulfide. Then you apply pressure so that this anvil comes and locks on this metal gasket. And now the hydrogen sulfide liquid that was here is now confined in between this tiny cavity made of these two diamond anvil surface and here the gasket. So now it cannot escape. Then you do a heating, you heat and you evaporate all the hydrogen sulfide that is outside, and that goes back. You can then pump it out, but the one that is trapped inside this remains, and that is on which you are doing your experiment. Now, as you know, as I have shown you before, in hydrogen sulfide, you have many, many possible structures that you can get at high pressure. And indeed, you get many of these structures here, which is why the data is a little tricky. Initially, you load the hydrogen sulfide the way I have shown. You cool it at 100 Kelvin, then you measure resistance when heating. You see a TC at 170 Kelvin. And then at some temperature here, there is some kind of structural transformation and the resistance again drops to this value. After this, when you cool it and heat it, your TC has increased to 195 Kelvin, but this annealing process retains it here. So the point is, in all these experiments that they have done subsequently, they did this annealing process in order to get the highest TC. And then once you get the TC, you do this cycling several times to verify that you are getting the same TC after the annealing, that it doesn't just keep on changing randomly.
Pratap, there is one question from Rajan actually. He says that the diamond cell seems to have a hole drilled in it. How are you retaining the pressure if it has a hole in it?
Where is the hole? There is no... So once this diamond, once this blue diamond here is pressed on this gasket, there is no hole here. This, I am showing you the cross-sectional view. So this is a circular gasket. Is it clear?
I guess Mr. Nagarajan can say yes or no.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. Go ahead.
I can't hear anything.
He said thank you, I thought.
Okay, all right. All right. So let me, yeah. So now they did this experiment. Interestingly, they also did isotope effect. So with hydrogen, this hydrogen sulfide, which is with hydrogen, this you get 195 K Tc. Then if you do the same experiment with deuteride, then you get Tc, which is 150 Kelvin. So this is again what you expect from DCS theory. This is just one set of data for one particular pressure. This is what is shown for hydrogen sulfide and hydrogen deuteride. Sorry, this is hydrogen deuteride. This one is hydrogen deuteride and this one is hydrogen sulfide. So you have this isotope effect. There seems to be some anomaly here, which is not very clear why. You also see that with magnetic field, the superconducting transition is going to lower temperature. So you can get the upper critical field here as a function of temperature. And as I have mentioned, that the superconductivity here is history dependent. There are some temperature pressure paths, for example, which does not give you superconductivity at all. That is because you go into some other metastable state and you cannot detract your system from that. Now, this experiment was spectacular because this is already very, very difficult to acquire data, but they did even further and they did almost the unthinkable, which is measuring magnetization. So, Rasdeep, the answer to your question.
Yeah, I can see.
So, they fabricated a very specialized small pressure cell. They couldn't go to that high a pressure, but nevertheless, they could go up to 155 or 170 gigapascal. And then this is a miniature one that they can put inside a quantum design squid and then measure the magnetization. So this black one that you see is the magnetization in field cool and zero field cool. The zero field cool, you have this slope because remember, you are not measuring just the sample. The sample is just here. You are measuring this entire garbage, which is the actual diamond anvil cell also, which contains some metallic parts and so on, other than diamond. And then you can do the magnetization loop that shows you typical hysteresis behavior. You can get the critical field and so on. So this was a very important discovery. And it sort of showed that this process of using hydrogen dense compounds is likely to be successful. In fact, I would say personally, when you see this, am I audible? I saw a message that there was an internet problem.
In between you got cut off, but now you are audible again.
All right. Okay. So this was a very, very important discovery because it showed that this scheme of using hydrogen dense compounds and looking for superconductivity in them at high pressure is going to work. And in fact, when these people got the superconducting transition at 200 Kelvin, many of us believed that now essentially it's just a matter of time. So from 200, it will eventually, there is nothing sacrosanct about 200, it will go to 300, maybe 400, maybe 500. It's just a matter of time. It's just like high Tc cuprates. Bednors and Mueller got it at 40 Kelvin. But then from 40 Kelvin, it just within weeks smoothly went up to, not within weeks, within months, went up to something like 100 Kelvin. And the same thing would happen here probably. Nevertheless, things really moved actually fast. This is that same Chinese group. They started now looking at other hydrides. For example, they started looking at rare earth hydrides and they started looking what is called a superhydride. Superhydrides is when you have rare earth HN, where N is greater than 6. Now, these superhydrides are not things that you normally get at atmospheric, at ambient pressure. So they started exploring essentially through density functional theory on whether you can get these superhydrides at high pressure. And then if you get them, whether they will metallize and so on and so forth.
Pratap, there is a question which is probably about the previous slide.
Yeah.
Question was what you alluded to. How do you subtract the contribution of the rest of the setup in the diamond anvil cell when you are measuring magnetization?
Okay, the way you do it is you do it by measuring essentially a blank run. So you measure the diamond anvil cell without any sample.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you subtract that from the measurement with the sample. However, this subtraction procedure, because your sample is tiny, it is 30 micron by 5 micron, whereas your diamond anvil cell is a huge object. It's at least this big, let's say, half a centimeter in width and a few centimeter in length. The subtraction is not exact, and that is why you get some of these unusual slopes that you see. So this kind of problem is always there when you have to extract a small quantity by subtracting two large quantities. Okay. So these superhydrides, they explored many of them and they started looking at whether this could be a possible route to room temperature superconductivity. So there was first, so remember, there are two things in the game. One thing is that first you have to metallize an object and then you need to look for superconductivity. Here you had actually three parts in the game. You have to first see whether these superhydrides are at all possible to obtain and whether they are metallic and then they are superconducting. So at ambient pressure, for example, if you take this rare earth to be lanthanum, the only one that is stable is lanthanum H3. That's not a superhydride, that's lanthanum hydride or trihydride. So superhydride is when it goes 6 and above, and you need superhydride because remember for metallization you need a very high density of hydrogen. All right, so this group, which is this is a group where I think the main person is Somia Zulu. This is in Washington University, but more recently he has possibly moved to Oregon. I'm not completely sure. They measured lanthanum hydride, LaH3, under pressure and with excess of hydrogen, so that if the structure requires hydrogen, it can absorb hydrogen from the surrounding. This was just a structural study to see if superhydrides form. And what they saw is that actually they can get up to lanthanum H10 decahydride. But for that, what they have to do is they have to heat the sample at 180 gigapascal up to 1000 Kelvin for this reaction to happen. So this, I think, is possibly extreme chemistry. So it's chemistry under extreme pressure. So they found this, and then the next part was to measure resistance. They measured resistance, and they got a zero resistance state. So this paper actually was where superconductivity was reported just 13 Kelvin below room temperature. Now, I think these groups' main contribution, Somia Zulu's main contribution, is this paper. They actually showed that lanthanum hydrogen 10 is possible to synthesize, and they found how to synthesize it. The next paper is a hurried paper. It's essentially, you have done the hard work, now you are afraid that some other group will run away with all the claps. So you want to quickly claim the big result yourself, because this paper doesn't have much more than this data. So I think in isolation, these data wouldn't have stood the test of time. But it was very soon supported by this, by the group of Emirates in Max Planck Institute. They reproduced the data, and they did a much, much more careful job. So they produced lanthanum hydride in the same way. Then they got superconductivity. These are superconductivity for different pressures. They found that the superconductivity, the TC increases up to 250, to between 250 to 260 Kelvin at 160 gigapascal, and then it reduces again. Now, to get this kind of a neat superconducting transition, you really need to make sure that your entire sample is at is lanthanum decahydride, 10 hydrogen. But as you know, lanthanum, you have many superhydrides. You have anything almost between 10 and 6. So you have many other hydrides of of lanthanum. And if you do this experiment where you have not put enough hydrogen in your pressure cell, so that you have hydrogen deficiency, after a point, lanthanum cannot absorb any more hydrogen, then you form the other hydrides and you start getting this many different transition temperature. So it is expected that many of the other hydrides of lanthanum are also superconducting, but all of them at lower temperatures. If you put excess of hydrogen, so this is something I couldn't entirely figure out how the excess of hydrogen is put. But what they mention is if you put excess of hydrogen, then you get at another different phase. And this also has a TC which is about 210 Kelvin, that is lower. So lanthanum hydrogen 10 is the phase that gives you 260 Kelvin TC. In addition, they did isotope effect, and you see this very neat isotope effect here. When you put deuterium instead of hydrogen, then you have a shift of the transition to lower temperature. Okay, magnetization, they mentioned that they tried, but here, since the sample size had to be even smaller because they are dealing with a solid to start with, which is a tiny piece of lanthanum, they couldn't get enough signal after background subtraction to measure the magnetic response. Okay, so this is minus 13 Kelvin TC. So crossing a 13 Kelvin barrier, after crossing this barrier from 4.2 Kelvin to 260 Kelvin is just a matter of time. And this brings us to this immediate discovery, which is room temperature superconductivity in carbon sulfur hydrogen mixture. So again, this paper has insufficient detail. I think it's a paper that is published to state the claim of priority, and I'm sure more details would emerge later on. So what they mention is that they took a mixture of methane and hydrogen sulfide and loaded in the pressure cell. Loading details is not really given of how much methane, how much hydrogen sulfide. But then when you apply a pressure of 260 gigapascal, you get a TC which is about 285 Kelvin. So they measured at many different pressures, and this is really how the superconducting transition temperature varies with pressure, and it crosses the room temperature barrier at about 260 gigapascal. In this experiment, they did some magnetic measurement, though they are nowhere as neat as the one that you have seen before, which is the reason I believe that more detailed data would emerge either by this group or by some other group soon. So this is by Rangadias. Rangadias is the same person who had that very contested and probably wrong claim of metallic hydrogen as a student with Silvera. But this is from his lab now in Rochester, where he is a faculty member. And this is magnetic measurement, AC susceptibility response, where you see some signature of diamagnetism. They also measured the superconducting transition as a function of magnetic field. And you see that there is the upper critical field gradually reduces to lower temperature. The transition reduces to lower temperature with increasing field. Okay, structure and composition of the superconductor is not yet accurately known. So this brings me to the end of the story. So let me now wrap up in just two slides. This shows you how superconductivity has evolved over years. You had this discovery of superconductivity in mercury, and then this was at 4.2 Kelvin. Then you had lead, niobium nitride, and the TC gradually kept on increasing. This was mainly a work of people like material scientists like Mathias, and it reached something like 23 Kelvin in niobium germanium. This is the time when there was intense theoretical activity. First, we had London and London theory. The London brothers gave their phenomenological theory of superconductivity, followed by the more sophisticated Ginzburg-Landau phenomenological theory. And then, of course, the Bardeen-Cooper-Schiffer theory, which is possibly one of the spectacularly successful many-body theory. So this Bardeen-Cooper-Schiffer theory, it essentially explained the entire gamut of superconductivity that was discovered, let's say, till 1987. So all these superconductors that you see here could be described in spectacular details with BCS theory or with slight extensions of BCS theory like Elias-Bark model, like Macmillan theory, and so on. Then came the discovery of high TC qubits. So this was a discovery that the first one was discovered in 1987 and the TC was 39 Kelvin. Then it jumped within no time to above liquid nitrogen. And then it even reached about 150 Kelvin or so. Theoretically, this ushered the age of confusion. Nothing that we learned from BCS theory, except possibly the very basic idea of Cooper pairing, worked for these superconductors. It became a field day for theorists because it was a complete confusion and you could have plenty of speculations. So you had magnetism, you had competing orders, you had magnetism, you had charge density wave. There were theories invoking quantum critical point. There were new jargons that were coined, marginal Fermi liquid, Fermi arc, superconducting dome. And it became sort of a nightmare for people like us who teach superconductivity when a student asks you, where should I read high TC from? So this confusion, it continues. There are almost as many theories for high temperature superconductivity in qubits as there are researchers trying to find theories. And there doesn't seem to be any resolution in sight yet. However, a glimmer of hope again emerged from this discovery here of MgB2. Here we have a new material composed of light elements, which was working extremely well with BCS theory. And now, 110 years after the discovery of superconductivity, with this room temperature superconductivity, BCS theory triumphs again. So, in all the predictions that have gone into this eventual culmination of room temperature superconductivity, everything is based on BCS theory. So for a long time, it was believed that these very imaginative theories were the root to high temperature superconductivity. It's proven that it is not so. Nature is much simpler, and BCS theory actually triumphs. Okay, so this is my last slide, and the one breakthrough has been achieved. Superconductivity is obtained at room temperature. The next real breakthrough is to removing the squeeze. Have this without the need of this humongously high pressure. Now, this is actually a structural chemistry problem. Now, structural chemistry works not, it is somewhat a science that works much more based on empirical rules and intuition than physicists would like. For example, in this particular room temperature superconductor, why was methane added in hydrogen sulfide? Now, I tried to read the paper, and there is no good reason written in the paper. So there are reasons that really don't make too much sense to me. There is a reference to Little's theory of superconductivity, which was for polymers. There is also this mention, to be politically correct, that this will make the superconductor more green because it will not have rare earth elements. Again, something that doesn't make any sense at all in this context. But then, of course, there are sometimes reasons, and there are sometimes good reasons of adding carbon, but reasons that you cannot write in a paper. Let me now just tell you a small anecdote. There is one superconductor only that has been discovered so far from India, and this has been discovered by our friend R. Nagarajan, friend and colleague of many years. And this is yttrium nickel borocarbide. Now, this is a family of superconductors, actually, because this yttrium you can replace by any of the rare earth and get many exotic phenomena like coexistence of magnetism and superconductivity and so on. Now, there is a small history behind this discovery of this compound. And 1 year before this paper appeared, where they discovered this superconductor, which had a TC of 12 Kelvin, they had published another paper in Solid State Communication, which was on yttrium nickel 4 boron. And here they had observed this tiny jump here. It was not coming to zero temperature, zero resistance at all. So this couldn't really be called superconductivity, but there was this jump here. So some of the students here suspected that maybe there could be superconductivity. They also saw some magnetic anomaly in the susceptibility. And then what did they do? Then someone had the idea that in this yttrium nickel boron, let's add carbon. And they added carbon, and this remarkable discovery was done of yttrium nickel borocarbide. This was the family of compound called quaternary borocarbides were discovered. Now you might ask, why was this carbon added there? Well, it depends on whom you ask in these authors. You will have slight variation of the story, but the essential story remains the same. So I will tell you the most interesting story that is there. But all other stories are also very similar. So there was a very good reason to add carbon, but not a reason that you could write in the paper. So what I am told by one of the students at that time is that the furnace in which this was being made had a pump which was not very good. So that pump used to sometimes spit out oil vapor and oil fumes. So these students at some point thought that maybe before he made this compound, yttrium, nickel, boron, the pump had spitted out oil inside the furnace. He didn't notice it. Or maybe after his cleaning, some trace of the oil remained. And therefore, when he tried to make this compound, carbon got incorporated in it. So therefore, if he deliberately incorporates carbon, he can actually stabilize the superconductor. This was how borocarbide was discovered. I have no clue of whether there is any such bad furnace, contamination from oil, or anything else that went into adding methane in carbon hydrogen sulfide here, but at least the paper doesn't say that. Well, if carbon was added, you also wonder why not boron? Because boron has many hydrides which are strongly covalent. You have borazine, you have diboran. Now, when I was talking with Arnagrajan says, oh, maybe they don't know that boron has hydrides. I doubt that very much. But who knows? It appears that people have not tried hydrides of boron, or they have tried and failed, and that's not mentioned anywhere. I don't know. There are also other routes that people are exploring. For example, the Chinese group is back on their job, and they are looking at much more complicated structures, and with the hope that in one of these structures you will possibly not have to apply external pressure and it will be already pre-pressurized enough to give you superconductivity at room temperature. So it's out in the open there and it's up for grabs, and this I think will be a very exciting time to see where this direction takes us. Okay, with that, I finish this review. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pratap. It was a very entertaining and educative review. So before we take up questions, maybe we can all just give Pratap a vote of thanks by, you know, virtual claps, or you can open your mics and clap. Yeah, and please type in questions. We will take it up. There's one question here from Subhajit Sinha, who said that, do we expect similar physics with alloys of other alkali metals or alloys of metals like scandium, which has only one d electron rather than one s electron? What do you think about that?
Okay, transition metals are normally much more complicated. So transition metals, I doubt, so the kind of arguments that went here would not really work for scandium, because scandium, first of all, is not that light. And secondly is that with d electrons, you have to bother much more about correlation effects.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very difficult question to answer, but I don't think that prima facie there is a reason to believe that the same physics would be applicable there.
Mm-hmm.
At the end, the point is that all these things, to a large extent, discovery of superconductivity is not always something that you can go by predictions. You can do small predictions by changing structures and so on, but completely new effects can come in. So therefore, transition temperature prediction is very difficult. These materials, I don't know whether anyone has looked at it carefully, but it's always good to try. For example, even the superconductivity discovery in bismuth, it's not something that prima facie you can predict that bismuth will become a superconductor, but it did happen at a very low temperature.
Okay, so there was a question from Shagni Ghosh about any research to observe superconductivity at lower pressure, but I guess you have already talked a little bit about that. Do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, so no, so that is actually the next direction is that. And that direction will actually be to have structures where you have very high density of hydrogen, high enough so that you can get a metallic state without applying pressure or by applying small pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is again where I think density functional calculations will play a very strong role, because this is something which you need some direction of chemistry and then this energetics calculation to see what kind of structure can accommodate that density of hydrogen.
One more question from Zoom before we go to YouTube questions. Nagarajan is asking, what about the critical field in the last one? Have they done any measurements?
Critical field, yes, they have done. Let me go back. Yes, the critical field is very high. Yes, they have done it here. This is the critical field.
Mm-hmm.
So the critical field, of course, at zero temperature is humongously high, so they could do critical field only close to TC.
Mm-hmm. So keep asking questions in the Zoom, but let me take a few from YouTube. So Navinder Singh asked a question. This was about your lanthanum D10, hydride. He was asking, did they also measure isotope effect just to make sure that superconductivity is phonon mediated in that case?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so here is the isotope effect.
Okay.
So this is isotope effect and it is consistent with the isotope effect in BCS.
Okay, so then there is a question from Vivek Polchettiwar, who is asking that in the last compound, methane can react with H2S under such huge pressure and in principle form new molecules.
Yes, that is correct.
What is the real molecule in that pressure gas? Yes.
So it. That is correct. And in fact, in this paper, at the end, they give a discussion, they have a long discussion on what could actually be the molecule that is superconducting at that high pressure. So it is definitely not a mixture of CH4 and H2S. It's actually a compound which is made out of this mixture. The problem is that, so it's a rather convoluted discussion because they couldn't exactly identify what is that particular molecule. So they did some Raman. They have only some speculation that it has this many sulfur, this many carbon, and so on. But the exact, and they did not do X-ray diffraction, by the way, on this one. X-ray diffraction is also very difficult because you don't have any heavy element. So the X-ray scattering cross-section is also very, very small. So the structure, they really don't know. And the composition also of the compound, really, they don't know very well.
Pratap, they know what they put in, right? So you mean that it could have phase separated into two different compounds or something? Sorry, this is Kedar.
Yeah, I know. So yes, so it has carbon, sulfur, hydrogen. There is some hydrogen that is in excess and it is outside. So it just remains as hydrogen.
Okay.
So carbon and sulfur, of course, whatever stoichiometry, CS, whatever stoichiometry you started with remains that only.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
So since the compound was very speculative in the discussion in this paper, I don't really remember what was the exact composition that was.
I see.
So one question from Adilsha PK, again from YouTube. So is there any one application of such high pressure superconductors? I guess.
Well, at this pressure, application is very difficult. No, there is none. I think there is only hope. There is no application yet.
So I remember being told in some other context that what sounds like an enormous pressure when you think of it as applying externally, it need not be a very big deal if you think of it as chemical pressure by changing the size of some ion. So is there something like this that is potentially...
Yes, absolutely. That's correct. In fact, that is the reason why you are able to get superconductivity in these hydrides of various kinds, whereas you cannot get it in hydrogen. So...
Right, but now is there some next logical step that everybody will be racing towards where you have a bigger ion that you put
into? I think that direction is not yet there. So this Chinese group is one of the group that I saw is looking at large variety of compounds using DFT calculation, essentially with that aim. But I don't think a very clear direction has yet emerged where, let's say, a chemist can start synthesizing these
possibilities. I see. So it's not just the size of the atom or ion or whatever. No, there's other things involved.
It is more than that. It is more than that because you see, you have to pack hydrogen very closely.
So structure also matters.
Exactly. And if you have a simple hydride, it would not work. Because you have so much hydrogen compared to the other element that the interaction between the other element with itself is not strong enough to squeeze.
Yes.
So you will have to get to ternary or quaternary compounds. Like that is why, for example, here it is lithium, magnesium, hydrogen. You need a complicated structure where you can squeeze the hydrogen. And that's more complicated.
Right.
I feel that it would happen, but how it will happen is not really clear at this stage.
So it's not like there's one direction in which everybody is racing. No, it's more like
yet.
A random search.
Not yet.
I see.
Okay. So, Pratap, so first a comment from Vivek from YouTube. He says thanks. They could, in principle, have GC-MS or NMR after experiment to identify molecular structure in principle. Probably have not done that, but they can.
Yeah.
But Sharon has a question here. Is there some understanding why the TC versus pressure curve suddenly changes its tendency beyond 225 gigapascal? If you look at how the TC changes with pressure.
Why it decreases here? Which one was that? I have not forgotten. Sorry.
No, I mean, it was probably at your second last slide in the corner.
Is this what you are? No, later.
In their material itself.
In this data.
Yeah, this one. The blue and the yellow thing.
Oh, why you have this and then this? I think at this pressure there is a structural phase transition. Yes.
Oh, okay, fine. It's so just structural.
There is some change of structure. So going from here to here, but as I mentioned, these structures, what they are, they don't know precisely.
Okay.
But they see some indirect changes in Raman lines from which they understand that there is a change happening here.
Okay.
It could be a change of structure, or not just of the structure, it could be also a change of the compound. So you could have, let's say, different sulfur carbon hydride forming.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
One more question from Surjit Singh from YouTube. He is asking, are optical phonons and light elements somehow at play here?
Yeah. So, optical phonons...
I think why the electron-phonon coupling is so strong in there.
Why is the electron-phonon coupling? Okay, electron-phonon coupling is strong, but it's not spectacularly strong. For example, for hydrogen, or in most of these compounds, the electron-proton coupling is about N0B minus mu is about 0.2, 0.3. So it's a spectacularly strong coupling. Or maybe it's a little more, but not in the very strong coupling limit. But what is the reason, what is large is actually if you take the hydrogen sublattice, then the debye energy becomes very, very large. So because you have this hydrogen mass, which is very small.
So it's not the stiffness, it's the mass essentially.
Exactly.
Okay. Okay, so...
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you.
I am going back to the diamond anvil cell. Mm-hmm. You show me the slide of the diamond anvil cell.
Yeah. Which one? The first slide? This slide?
First slide.
This one?
Next one? You had shown a hole drilled in it. That is what puzzled me.
Yeah,
that hole.
No, you are showing hole is not a through hole. This is just to show the dimension. It's a dotted line.
Okay. So, because somewhere you said drill a hole at the bottom.
No, you drill a hole only on this green thing.
Okay.
Yellow. Yellow orange thing, you drill a hole. The hole, if you want, is this red region.
Okay. To hold the sample.
Yeah, not through in the diamond.
Right. Okay. Thank you. And then a small comment. Since one of the authors of that borocarbide paper is in Bombay, that is me, probably I'll tell the story properly at some suitable time to the graduate students at TIFR.
If you want, you can tell it now, but can I ask others to mute themselves so that there's no background noise?
No, I think this is static from Professor Nagarajan's microphone itself, so I don't know. But Nagarajan sir, you can still continue, we can hear you. It will probably only...
No, I am through with my comment. I said maybe I will tell the story sometime to the graduate students.
It might actually be nice to have sort of a perspective talk in the journal club about the borocarbide discovery. Yes. Very topical.
We can have it after we go off live. So that's
I'm uncomfortable on the Zoom and online.
Okay,
so
when
on.
Things open, yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Jyotishman, did you have a question?
No, I just wanted to say that, first of all, very nice summary of a lot of work, Pratap. Thank you very much for doing this. And this will sort of also go into our discussion room later when we have it for the NSF colloquium discussion room. I just wanted to say, in some sense, maybe because I do not completely understand the BCS theory, it's just that it really is so powerful that even when the material is not well characterized, you can still uphold the theory with certain validations.
The point is that BCS theory has certain things, certain key predictions. For example, one of the key predictions of BCS theory is isotope effect. Tells you exactly how the TC will change when you change one element with an isotope of the same element, with a different isotope of the same element.
Yes.
So these are the things that you can verify whether your material follows BCS theory. Now what I'm saying is, in the BCS theory was used in all these predictions by theorists, by, for example, Ashcroft. All these papers of Ashcroft is essentially calculations using BCS theory.
Sure.
Since these are not so well characterized, it doesn't mean that they get these pressures or the TC very well. So you saw, for example, there was in hydrogen sulfide, the predicted TC was 80 Kelvin. And when they measured, the TC was 203 Kelvin.
That's right.
So this is the thing.
And then the other thing is, how much fraction of the sample is really superconducting?
So that is not very easy to estimate. Since that standard ways of estimating these failed here, because you cannot, you can measure the magnetization signal in some cases, as I have shown you, but to get the absolute value of the magnetization is very, very difficult.
Okay.
So the superconducting volume fraction is not well, very well characterized. But then it is large enough that you get a zero resistance in many of the cases. In many of the cases, the zero resistance is very, very zero. So for example, you see here, in this data, which is for hydrogen sulfide, the zero resistance is zero within, let's say, 0.05 milliohm.
Milliohm, and that's standard. That's what you expect.
Yeah, that is, that's very much standard.
Okay. Okay.
And
thank
then,
you.
For this specific measurement, also, okay, I haven't. Sorry, no. This is lanthanum hydride. For this measurement also, for many of their samples, I don't have the expanded view
yet,
it is also very close to zero. In some of the runs, they have mentioned in the supplementary material, it did not come exactly to zero, and that is because, again, they think that it went into a mixture of two different phases.
Right. And the other comment is about the Raman shifts. I think they just... they just show some changes. They are not very quantitative in terms of...
That is right. That's right. That is why... So here they have done the only other diagnostic other than resistivity and susceptibility is Raman.
Yeah.
And because Raman cannot show you the structure really directly, that is why the structure is so speculative.
Yeah, yeah.
So, by the way, there is one important experimental thing that I forgot to mention. I had shown you before in the beginning that in a pressure cell, in a diamond anvil cell, you put a ruby in order to calculate, in order to measure the pressure.
Calibrate the pressure. Yeah.
Calibrate the pressure. Now that is for regular diamond anvil cells, which are in this 10 to 15 gigapascal range. When you go to things like 500 gigapascal, the one that I was showing here mostly, you don't have to use this ruby and you don't have enough space because you have to really make this space tiny. Right. So you don't have enough space to put the ruby. But the advantage is that then you can use the diamond line of the diamond Raman line itself to measure the pressure.
Right. Okay.
Because the diamond at that pressure, it gets buckled a little bit.
Right.
And that buckling can be quantitatively
For the carbon, okay, exactly. great, thank you.
Razdeep, you're muted if you're trying to speak.
Thanks, everybody, and it has been a fantastic 2 hours.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, Razdeep.
We will have to end it here for today. It's almost 6 o'clock. But once more, let us thank Pratap for you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pratap.